Good morning. Grace and peace to you. I'm Pastor Hannah. Along with all our worship leaders, I'd like to welcome you to our worship at Community United Methodist Church. Today is a Sabbath day in honor of God's rest. On the seventh day of creation, we gather now to rest and to worship. So I pray that our worship today will be a time of rest and renewal in our relationship with God. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Now let us join in singing our opening song.
This is the time, no more delay. This is the Lord. Lord of love and mercy, we come to you this day at the beginning of summer season. This should be a time of relaxation and restoration, but our spirits still carry the burdens of the year. Please give us your healing love. Strengthen us. We offer our cares and prayers to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Tom and Sylvia Kupferer have been active members of our church for many decades. So it is sad to see them go, but we also know that it is a good move for them. So we will take a moment to send them off with our blessings. We will hear a few words from Tom and Sylvia first, and then pray together. You may also want to write your words of good wishes for Tom and Sylvia during our passing of the peace.
Tom and I have been talking about our move and the emotions that I can't do it. You're going to have to do it.
Well, anyhow, you know, one of the things that, that drew us to the church 40 years ago, I guess, was that it was such a welcoming and friendly congregation. And the other thing was, of course, the Sunday schools and the preaching and the music. And there was just so much about the church that was so positive. I've told Sylvie several times that I can't remember any member of the congregation I didn't like. So that's just the kind of place that community church is. Mm-hmm. And so we're going to really miss it. We're going to miss all the friends that we've made here.
What would be the one thing that you would really miss about community UMC?
That's hard to say because there's so many things that have been important to us. Mm-hmm. Just the willingness to try new things. That's how the senior program really grew up, is people would say to me, do you think we could do an exercise group? What would you think about creating a service for people who have disabilities? Could we do a community education program on Sunday? What are we going to do about flu shots? Things like that. And it's just very open to come and say, can we do it? And then when I posed the question, can we do it? People responded. And that's been a very important part of what was very satisfying, I guess. Rewarding to see that I was able to help people bring their ideas into practice.
The other thing we'll really miss is especially our Sunday school class.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
Because what brought us there, one of the first things was Sojourners. And we formed a lot of close friendships with the people in that class. And of course now we've got the forum people there too. But a lot of really close friendships there, that ability to connect and have people that you could talk to and that you learned there about their lives. And it just was a very satisfying part of the church for me.
We can't forget the music program.
Yes.
Oh, my
the
gosh.
The music program has always been a strong thing for the church.
And Chris has been incredible to work with. He's just so talented and so inventive too about how to bring programs to the people who are interested in that, that kind of thing. And it's just been wonderful to be able to not only help to bring them to the congregation, but to just sit back and enjoy them. God bless you, continue to bless you.
And thank you for all that you've done for us.
Yeah.
Now, it is such a sad time, but we know that it is a good move for Tom and Sylvia. So we would like to send them off with our prayers and with our blessing. So I will be praying and let us all join in praying together. And you may, at home, you may want to just extend your hand over the screen in an act of praying together. So let us pray. Oh, gracious and loving God, we know that we have been so
blessed with Tom and Sylvia, their ministry, their leadership, and their engagement in our church programs and activities. Now, as they move to Louisiana and begin a new church there, we know that just as they've been such a blessing for us, they will be a blessing in their new church, new community, and people there. So we pray that that they would know that they are going with our blessings. And we pray that you would bless them so abundantly. And wherever we are, help us to know that we are all connected with your love and with your spirit. Oh, gracious and loving God, we thank you so much for the love, compassion, ministry, and care that Tom and Sylvia shared with us. And as we say goodbye, we know that all their spirit that they have shared will always stay within us. So please, we pray that that you would let them know that our love goes with them as well. In Jesus' name, all God's people say, Amen. Amen.
Good morning. Please stand as you are able and greet the others in your presence with signs of God's peace and love. You can also use the YouTube live chat to say hello. The peace of Christ be with you. I haven't seen you in such a long time. Today, I wanted to talk to you a little bit about something that you're going to hear in the scripture. But first, I have a question. Have you ever tried to do something that was really hard? Have you ever tried to carry something that was really, really heavy? One day, a couple of weeks ago, when it was a little bit colder, Tyler and I were outside. He was trying to carry a really big rock. It was so heavy and he needed help to pick it up. Have you ever needed to do that? Maybe you're trying to help carry in the groceries or you found something or you're taking your baseball things to the car and they're so heavy and you need some help. One of the words that we have in our scripture today is the word yoke. The first thing I think about when I hear a yoke is when I'm cooking and I use eggs. Because all that yellow stuff on the inside, that's the yolk. But you know what? That's not the yolk that we're talking about in our scripture. Today in our scripture passage, Jesus says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me. He also says, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And I was thinking about, what does that mean? Because a burden is something that's maybe heavy or hard. And I was thinking about the word yoke. I found a picture of a yoke. And it's something that if we were farmers, especially farmers that didn't have a lot of the tractors and things that we have now, you would have seen a yoke. This is a picture of what a yoke looks like. And that looks a little bit confusing until I show you that picture. Some places use cows or oxen or animals like that that are very strong to help pull wagons or tractors or things like that. And if they can put the yoke on them, then two can carry them together. If two people carry something, is it a lot lighter? Yeah. So that is something for you to think about when you listen to Pastor Jeremiah's sermon today. Think about if there are times that you ask for help to carry something heavy or do something hard. Have a great week, and I'll see you later.
That's okay, cause it don't take much at all. You can start right where you are. It don't matter how small.
Oh, and you scared your voice. Won't ever be heard above the crowd. Well, my friend, here's your chance to live a life.
Change the day. You could be the miracle that someone's waiting for. All it takes is just one thing. You can light up the darkest place. You'd be amazed. A little bit of love goes a long, long way.
Turn this whole wide world around, and with just one dream, you can flip it upside down.
Cause the smallest faith from a heart that believes can overcome the impossible. You can make history.
Change the day. You could be the miracle that someone's waiting for. All it takes is just one flame, and you can light up the darkest place. Well, you'd be amazed. A little bit of love goes a long, long way.
Don't waste another minute. To change somebody's life.
A little bit of love goes a long, long way. A little bit of hope can change the day. Are you the miracle someone's waiting for? All it takes is just one flame, and you can light up the darkest place. Oh, you'd be amazed. A little bit of love goes a long, long way. You'd be amazed. A little bit of love goes a long, long way.
Today's scripture reading is from the book of Matthew, chapter 11, verses 16 through 19, and verses 25 through 30. But to what will I compare this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling to one another. We played the flute for you, and you did not dance. We wailed, and you did not mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking. And they say, he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, look, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Yet wisdom is vindicated by her deeds. At that time, Jesus said, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father. and no one knows the Son except the Father. No one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light.
I would like to start by sharing a picture with you. What do you think this is? Yes, you got it. It is a yoke. Do you know how it works? As you see on the picture, a yoke was a harness used with the oxen and other animals to ease the work of hauling a load. We don't see them very often here in our modern world because deers and cats, John Deeres and caterpillars have taken over the work of plowing. The only place where we might see one is if we went to a farm museum. However, in biblical times, it was a familiar term to most people because many farmers depended on cows or other animals to plow the ground. So it makes sense in a parable told by Jesus. The word yoke has many meanings besides its use as a harness. It was also meant as a designation of servitude and carrying the burden of a task or mission. In ancient culture, the word yoke was a term that was used to describe submission. So when someone was described as being yoked to someone or something, it was communicating the idea that he or she was in submission to that person or thing. As we think about the meaning of the word yoke, we realize that everyone is yoked to someone or something. When we are yoked to someone or something, it can mean that we are under its control. We can take that idea further by saying that some people are yoked to a job, some are yoked to their family. On the negative side, some people are yoked to the power of sin, and some are yoked to the world of discrimination and injustice. And on the positive side, some people are yoked to Jesus. Depending on who or what you yoked to, it can be a good thing or it can be burdensome. The question is, to whom or to what do you want to be yoked? Let's look at the scripture that we read today and see how Jesus described his generation. It says, they are like children sitting in the marketplace and calling to one another. We played the flute for you and you did not dance. We wailed and you did not mourn. Who or what do you think they are yoked to? I think they are yoked to their self-righteousness. They rejected both Jesus and John's teaching. The following verse shows us that. It says, for John came neither eating or drinking, and they said, he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they said, look, a glutton, and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. They rejected John and called John a demon, because John had appeared robed as a prophet, living an ascetic life in the wilderness, teaching fasting and repentance and announce and judgment and doom. For the axe is already at the root of the tree, he said in Matthew 3:10. This generation found the message too harsh to accept, and it would have preferred a less severe prophet, one that responded to their invitation to dance with joy before the Lord. They believed they were entitled to joy without radical repentance. Yet, when Jesus came announcing the wedding feast with no need to fast, his own personal fellowship with tax collectors and sinners was such a radical reversal of the conduct approved by the righteous that they accused him of being a sinful libertine. They called Jesus a glutton and a drunkard. Apparently, this generation preferred to have Jesus participate in a more solemn game because they believed the time of salvation had not yet come and the time of mourning was not yet over. This generation was unbelieving and unrepentant. They could not accept either the stern message of John or the joyful message of Jesus. Their burden came from their inability to see the truth, the way, the life. How about us? What brings worry and burden in our lives? Are we seeking a purpose in life? Are we looking for meanings? You know, Jesus did not just leave them alone and leave us hanging, but offered an invitation to come follow me and take my yoke upon you, and I will give you rest for your soul. We are weary and carry heavy burdens. Maybe we are too focused on gathering things for ourselves and not giving to others. Maybe we are too self-righteous and focused on serving our own self-interest. In Isaiah chapter 58, God says to his people, "I don't want you to fast when you do it just for yourself, but I want you to repent and be humble yourself." Then verse 6 says, "Is not this the kind of fasting I have chosen? To loosen the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke? To set the oppressed free and break every yoke?" What God wants is for us to get rid of our self-righteousness, to get rid of our self-interest, and to come to God. And Jesus said, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. My yoke is easy and my burden is light." Instead, why? Why wouldn't we just avoid yokes altogether and do our own thing? Ironically, there is a comfort in being yoked to something or someone. When it is benevolent entity, we must learn the ways of living for somewhere and being completed on our own can be intimidating and overwhelming. Jesus is offering us an opportunity to learn from him and serve a righteous purpose, making our lives easier and meaningful. Let me share a story about how people used to use a yoke back in the old days. They used a yoke for training animals. Two oxen are chosen to share a yoke. And they don't put two young oxen together. And they put an older, seasoned ox first. He is trained and hardy from years of routine. Then a new young ox goes next to the older one. He has potential, but is inexperienced. By sharing the same yoke, the older one trains the younger one. Not only that, but the experience one draws harder to bear the majority of the load. Since the older one leads, The younger oxen does not have to wonder what to do. He learns from his mentor and gains the knowledge and skill to teach others, just as we learn by being yoked to Jesus, our teacher. This very much resembles discipleship. Jesus invites us to learn of him, which is another way of stating, be my disciple. What Jesus wants us to learn about is his gentleness and humbleness. The dictionary tells us that gentleness is an adjective, and that gentle means considerate in disposition, mild in mood, soft, tender, well-managed, not sudden or rash or anger, taking care not to harm others. The Greek terms for gentleness is paratus, which is about mildness or meekness of spirit. It also shares the same idea, taking care not to cause harm. We are invited to learn not to cause harm to others. How does all of this relate to what is going on in our world today? What would our teacher, Jesus, said about the state of things in the United States right now? During the last two Saturdays, I attended a workshop about systematic racism and learned that racism is more than just race prejudice. It is more than individual attitudes and actions. Racism is the collective actions of a dominant racial group. A systematic racism is systematic power that turns race prejudice into racism. Racial prejudice becomes racism when one group's racial prejudices are enforced by the systems and institutions of a society, giving power and privilege based on race to the group in power, and limiting the power and privilege of the racial groups that are not in power. Although we did not create the system, we need to understand that systematic racism is doing harm to many people. Our teacher, Jesus, who invites sinners, tax collectors, Gentiles, and everyone from every level to join him, will tell us to think about how systematic racism separates us from one another, how it stands in the way of opening our hearts. Another characteristic that Jesus wants us to learn is to be humble in heart. What does that mean? C.S. Lewis once said, humility is not think less of yourself, it's thinking of yourself less. Being humble in heart means that we think of others more often than we think of ourselves. Not thinking about what we want or what will benefit us, but how we can serve others. John Wesley puts it this way, do all the good you can. Jesus is inviting us to become yoked to him, to let him disciple us. He will bear the weight of our burdens. He tells us that his yoke is good and we will find rest and companionship in our labor together as we loosen the chain of injustice and untie the cords of yoke of sin and set the oppressed free and break every yoke that brings harm. Find rest for your soul in Christ. Amen.
Mm-hmm. Lord, we are called to be light for the kingdom, to live in the freedom of the city of God.
In our prayers today, let us remember our nation on this Independence Day weekend. And if you have any prayer requests, send your request to us using the link below. We are here for you. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you today for the celebration of our nation's Independence Day. We are grateful for those who have sacrificed so much for the freedom and sovereignty that we enjoy today. We also recognize that the creation of a nation on this land that now we call the United States meant suffering and loss for those who have lived here for a long time. As we celebrate and enjoy our nation's independence, help and guide us also to remember the pains and tears of Native Americans. As we pray for your guidance for our nation and the world, we recognize that this has been a tough year with the global pandemic, economic crisis, and racist violence. Help us to continue to commit ourselves to be the community as Jesus started and envisioned. Comfort us when we cry with victims, and inspire us in our efforts to be part of the solutions. Be with our political leaders so that they may make decisions for the health and wholeness of all our citizens. In this election year especially, we pray that you will enable us to elect wise leaders for our country. As always, help us to practice your teachings of love, peace, and justice in our daily life. In Jesus' name we pray, and we continue to pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Hi. My name is Katie Lapham, and I am here to tell you a little bit about my faith story. When Pastor Hannah asked me to share, my first instinct was, no, I can't do it. It's too hard. It's too challenging. It's too uncomfortable. But with a little reflection, I decided that I would try. And with that thought and reflection, I realized that trying is a really big part of my faith journey. Trying things that help me see God in the world is a big part of my journey. And it started when I was 11 years old. My mom invited me and encouraged me and kind of made me come to church with her for 1 year. Well, that 1 year commitment has turned into a lifetime of a faith journey where I continue to grow and search and learn and try my best to see God in the world. And through preparing for this talk, I realized I have some faith tenets that I wanted to talk a little bit about. And one of them is friendship, community through friendship in other people who are searching to do and find God in our world, who are striving to be God's hands in the world. And through those friends and friendships, I can question my faith. I can discuss ideas about how to better our world, how to strengthen my own inner faith. I find encouragement through my friends, and I find support there too. So that's very important to me. Another tenet of my faith is experiences. The action of faith really speaks loudly to me. So serving and also being served is something that means a lot to me and my faith. So working at PADS, my family set up PADS for 10 or 12 years. Now I go in the mornings and help clean up after PADS with a group of people. I love working in groups together for others. I work for Hesed House and bring meals and donations there, loaves and fishes. I worked with a group, my covenant group, that cleaned loaves and fishes for years. I've been a Sunday school teacher. I love being a Sunday school teacher. I sing for On Center, and that brings me so much joy. It fills me, and I feel faith through music. And I'm learning how to work for equality for all people. I feel and find God through faith and action. Another thing that I've realized is that a habit of church and a habit of searching for faith is something that's very important to me and is one of the tenets of faith. Church is a good, healthy habit for me in my life. Habits can help our brains to function more effectively. Good habits promote comfort, good habits enhance our outcomes in our life, and habits become the patterns with which we view ourselves, others, and the world around us. And I have come to need church and the love of the church people, you, thank you, in order to find the best self and to see the best in others. This week when I was doing yoga, Adrian on Yoga by Adrian on YouTube said that the magic happens when you show up consistently. And that's true for me with my faith. The last tenet that I'm going to talk about is reflection. Being quiet and listening is something that I'm learning how to do. It doesn't come naturally to me, but I'm trying and I'm learning how to do that. And it's there where I hear God, and I've really learned to come to value that through walks, yoga, nature, looking at the ocean, sitting in my backyard like I am now. Faith to me makes me feel grounded, makes me feel hopeful, and it helps me keep trying to do my best to keep discerning the will of God in my life and in our world. Thank you for your support on my journey. I love you, and I love our church.
Good morning. We've been given so much, and our offering is an opportunity to give back to God. One of the best gifts we give is our presence. We are so glad you are here with us today. Whatever device you are on, whether you are in pajamas or your Sunday best, we're happy you're here. Please share your presence with us today by entering your attendance on onecumc.net/attendance. Thank you also for your generous financial support of our church. There are several ways to give. You can send your check to the church, give online at onecumc.net/donate, or set up an automatic transfer with your bank. Let us give generously and joyfully. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for the blessings of today and all our days. May your goodness and love be affirmed in the gifts we give. Today and in the week to come, may we be extravagant in generosity and in our compassion for all. Amen.
Thank you for joining us in our worship today. If you are here for the first time, please check us out on our website at onecumc.net. This is an Independence Day weekend, so I pray that you will spend a wonderful time with your loved ones for the rest of the day. Next Sunday, we will do a pulpit exchange with Morgan Park United Methodist Church. This is a reconciling congregation like us. And also this church is in the Northern Illinois Conference. So I will be preaching at Morgan Park UMC, and their pastor, Reverend Dennis Langdon, will be preaching at our church. I've known Reverend Langdon for many years. We've worked together for many years at Board of Ordained Ministry. He is one of the most authentic persons I've known. I'm sure you will like him very much. And I hope that this pulpit exchange will lead to more congregational exchanges in the future. So now let us join in singing with our on-center band.
Ooh. Ooh. I can see the clouds rolling. I can feel the winds, they try to shake me. I will not be moved, my feet are on the rock. I can feel the waters rise. I can hear the howling lies that haunt me. Fear won't hold me now. My feet are on the rock.
When I feel my hope about to break, I will cling to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come and the earth give way.
Solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock.
On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock.
On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock.
When I feel my hope
God, who has given you rest and peace, will go with you as you go forth from this place and into the world. Feel the healing love of God in your life. Bring the good news of God's love to all whom you meet. Go in peace. Amen.
Thank you.